Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. We are so glad that you're here with us. Please do check in while you're here, just so that we know you're present with us. And just a few announcements before we get into worship. Our first communion classes for fifth grade and older students will be this Sunday and then next Sunday at 11:30. The students will take their first communion at our Maundy Thursday service. If you have a student who is fifth grade or older who has not had communion instruction, they are obviously invited to that, and they are at 11:30 after those two worship services. This year, we're asking people during Lent to help residents of PATH who obtain housing but don't have the money for needed supplies, to help those folks get the kind of supplies they need when they move into their new place, to help people get started on a new life. PATH Home Kit list is available in the sanctuary and online. Our Lent and Easter project is to support Rise Against Hunger. All donations will go to purchase food that will be shipped to hungry people somewhere in the world. Dedication cards are available online. You can make a donation online and you can sign up to participate in the packing of the meals at 9 a.m. on Saturday, April 29. With that, let's begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Shine into our hearts, Lord, the light of your love and your peace. Let us experience your presence in a way that changes us, transforming us into the people you would have us be. Open our minds to knowledge and understanding of your word, and inspire us to think and act according to your will, serving our neighbors with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our scripture passage today is from Colossians chapter 3, beginning at the 12th verse. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God in the Father through him. That's the end of the reading. And now we'll hear an inspiring message from Pastor Bob.
Let me begin with a poem, Compassion by Miller Williams. Have compassion for everyone you meet, even if they don't want it, what seems conceit. Bad manners or cynicism is always a sign of things no ears have heard, no eyes have seen. You do not know what wars are going on down where the spirit meets the bone. The late Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, in her book Fascism, A Warning, wrote, "The wise response to intolerance is not more intolerance or self-righteousness. It's a coming together across the ideological spectrum of people who want to make their country, their world better. We should remember that the heroes we cherish, Lincoln, King, Gandhi, Mandela, spoke to the best within us. The crops we'll harvest depends on the seeds we sow." If we open our eyes, we have so many great examples of how to sow these good seeds. A model of sowing these good seeds can be found in the beautiful read, The Book of Joy. It's actually a book. It's a week-long discussion on how to discover and understanding the meaning of true joy. It's a conversation that takes place between Archbishop Desmond Tutu, an Anglican, the Dalai Lama, a Buddhist, and Douglas Abrams, a Jew, who was the interviewer and moderator of the discussion. The Dalai Lama and the Archbishop are both great spiritual leaders in our world today, and they've found a way to transcend their own religious traditions and differences, to speak from a place centered on respect, love, and a deep compassion for all humanity. They are a vibrant example of the crops we will harvest depends on the seeds we sow. Now, I am not much of a gardener, but I do know this much. There is nothing to harvest if we don't sow the seeds. And if you want to grow tomatoes, you don't plant pumpkins. And if you want to see love flourish, you cannot plant hatred or intolerance. In the well-known prayer for peace attributed to St. Francis of Assisi, it says, "Where there is hatred, let me sow love." In the Bible passage we heard this morning, we have a laser focus on how we are to live. From the prophet Micah, we also have that same kind of focus. This was written about 800 years before Jesus' birth. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? In order for you and I to live out the great commandment of loving God and loving one another as we love ourselves, we have to clothe ourselves in love, as Paul says. And we must be committed to and dedicate ourselves to the work of Micah's call, to be just, kind, and humble. We do that with this new wardrobe that Paul describes in Colossians, clothing ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Clothing ourselves ultimately in love. Now, this isn't the pie-in-the-sky rom-com kind of love. This is a love that emanates and radiates from the conviction deep within our soul that we are all, every one of us, created in the image and the likeness of this loving God. And God bestows on each and every one of God's creation infinite value and dignity. Yes, even the person you vehemently disagree with. When we hear the words to love one another, it means to love even them. Remembering constantly that who and what God creates, God loves, and who and what God creates, God loves forever. No one person, no one group gets a bigger slice of the pie. We equally share it. And we equally bear the identity of God's chosen, holy, and beloved children. Now, that's quite a different message than we're barraged with on social media, from cable news, partisan politicians and campaigns, and sadly, even from many Christians who want to exploit our differences, drill down on our deepest fears, and continually seek to dehumanize those with different perspectives and life narratives than ours. What I'm offering today from God's Word is how God wants us to be clothed for this journey. And what being clothed in love looks like. Beyond nice-sounding words, what does it mean to be clothed in compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience? And what does that have to do with responding to what God tells Micah that God requires of us to do justice, to be merciful, and walk humbly with God? I want to lay down a challenge to every one of us here today. Let's call it the Micah 6:8 challenge. Or maybe it's more about a commitment than just a challenge. What if, as a follower of Jesus, I commit to doing whatever it takes to bridge the divide between myself and those who see the world differently? Imagine what would happen if all Christians set an example and made a commitment to put on some new clothes, to clothe ourselves in love and to be just and kind and humble in every single one of our interactions with others. If we all committed to show up in the places where people are treated unfairly, adding our voice and our resources to the efforts that make for a better world, to do all that we could do to make for peace in our homes, our communities, and our world, and doing so with kindness and humility, especially with those and towards those who don't share our point of view. What we all have are some blind spots, myself included. Blind spots is how to participate in a world and pulling everyone together. Blind spots on how I participate at times in creating divided tribes and unsafe, unloving conditions through actions and speech or by what I choose not to do or say. It's crucial that each and every one of us takes a look at ourselves in the mirror and our own actions and our own words. And this challenge invites us to do just that. And then we commit ourselves to becoming more fully who God created us to be, clothing ourselves in the clothing that God wants us to be clothed in, striving daily to live out the highest ideals as human beings, knowing full well that at times we will stumble, we will fall short, we will miss the mark. But as lovers and followers of Jesus, we also realize at this point, we don't rationalize those times when we've fallen short. We don't dig in our heels and continue down that path. No, we open ourselves up to the love and the forgiveness of God, the very thing that is offered at the communion table. We live in and we receive the grace that God gives to us here. And then we share that with others. For those of us who are followers of Jesus, this is not optional. It is what is required of us to do. This is the way of God's love. Franciscan priest Richard Rohr wrote in Jesus, Our Reference Point, that true spiritual action as opposed to reaction demands our ongoing and radical transformation, and it often requires us to change sides so we can be where pain is. It even requires a new identity, as Jesus exemplified in his great emptying, self-emptying. It feels like weakness, but it finally changes things in very creative, patient, and humble ways. Hopefully all of you have the chance to really take a look at this Micah 6:8 challenge. It's going to be on the screen. Let's read it out loud together. Micah 6:8 challenge. Each day, I will renew my efforts to live out Micah 6:8 in every relationship in my life, to act justly and pursue justice by standing with and speaking out for those who are vulnerable, mistreated, in need, or exploited, to exercise kindness and mercy in every interaction, even with those who look, speak, act, think, believe, and vote differently than I do. To act with humility, surrendering my will to God's will, acknowledging that I may not always be right and should listen more and speak less. The prophet Micah, the apostle Paul, and Jesus, the very Son of God, all exhort us to this kind of kindness and love in all our encounters with others. What I hope you will do is sign this challenge. Put it up on a mirror at home or on a fridge somewhere where you will see it and recommit to it each day. Take a moment right now. Take a moment each day to be self-reflective. And think about how both your actions and your words, how do they live up to this challenge? How do I act towards others? How do I speak to and about others? Are kindness and love the generating force of how I act and speak to and about others? Do love, justice, kindness, mercy, compassion, humility inform what I do and how I do it? Does it inform what I say to others? Sometimes I find myself speaking in an unloving manner to or about someone else. And you know, I have plenty of ways to rationalize it when I do, to cover up my shame over my behavior, knowing full well it's not in alignment with how God exhorts me to live and love. Culturally, many of our role models these days exhibit increasingly rude, abrasive, intolerant, and sometimes just downright cruel language towards people in a different tribe than ours, politically, religiously, ethnically, sexually, economically. And it has become, unfortunately, acceptable and a normal part of daily conversation. Let me be abundantly clear. It is not acceptable behavior in the sight of God. It is not how God wants any holy, chosen, loved child to behave. And each of you, all of us, are those very holy, chosen, and loved children. We know there are plenty of examples of hatred and unloving and unkind behavior in our world these days. And there is something wrong in our world where when people go to church or a synagogue or a movie theater or a concert, that they are shot. Something is wrong in our world when people are hated and mistreated because of the color of their skin, the way they dress, who they love, or the God they worship. And it's tempting to say, what can I do? And many of us, we don't participate in those horrible actions, but we just remain silent about them. Please don't misunderstand what kindness and love look like. It doesn't mean that we don't speak out against the horrific and the hateful behaviors in our world. Kindness and love requires that we find ways to respond while we guard our hearts and minds from exhibiting exactly the same behavior we're speaking out against. In our Lenten study by Adam Hamilton in the book Luke, Jesus and the Outsiders, Outcasts and Outlaws, this past week he reflected on the parable that Jesus tells about a very self-righteous religious leader whose prayer is primarily an exercise in arrogance as he thanks God that he is not such a miserable bloke as these others are. Then this self-righteous man proceeds with a list of all the things he sees these terrible people doing, and he tells God, I am so glad I'm not like them. And Jesus' point to this parable is that God was not impressed. Remember, the wise response to intolerance is not more intolerance or self-righteousness. And the crops we will harvest depend on the seeds we sow. Bishop Marianne, Episcopal Bishop of the Diocese of Washington, shares this account of a British comedian, Tony Hendra, who once tried to describe to his spiritual mentor, a gentle Benedictine monk named Father Joe, the actual function of satire humor, told at the expense of another person. And Father Joe didn't understand. He seemed confused. Satire always divides people up into two groups. Yes, Tony replied. Is that a good thing? The monk asked. What's the way the world works, Father Joe? People think in teams. We're good, you're evil. We're right, you're wrong. We're smart, you're dumb. And most humor works that way, even the most basic jokes. The English tell Irish jokes. Americans tell Polish jokes because Poles have been stereotyped as stupid. Oh, tell me a Polish joke, Father Joe said. Okay, what has an IQ of 212? Well, I don't know. Warsaw. Father Joe gazed up, expecting something more. Was there a joke coming? Well, that's it. The entire city of Warsaw has a combined IQ of 212. Oh, Father Joe protested. But the Poles are rather sensitive people, tragic and poetic and long-suffering. Look at Chopin and the Holy Father. Okay, Chopin and John Paul II are not Polish jokes, but the dynamic holds for jokes about politicians, opposing political parties, or blondes, or the French. And Father Joe looked puzzled. To say that people are stupid when they're not, isn't that cruel? He was silent for a moment. You see, dear, I think there are two types of people in the world. Those who divide the world into two types of people, and those who don't. So let's ask ourselves right now, what type of person are we? What type of person do I want to be? If we are followers of Jesus, what type of person is he calling us to be? Benedictine nun Joanne Chittister writes, "The godly are those who never talk destructively about another person, in anger, in spite, in vengefulness, and who can be counted on to bring an open heart to a closed and clawing world." She goes on, "The holy ones are those who live well with those around them. They are just, they are upright, they are kind. The ecology of humankind is safe with them." Is the actual care of all God's family of humankind safe with us? If we're honest, or at least speaking for myself, if I'm honest, not always. I just bought a new sweatshirt a few weeks ago with a great message on it. It says, "Humankind, be both." Every time I wear it, I'm reminded that I can do better, and perhaps you can too. Our Thin Spaces Women's Book Group just finished Bishop Michael Curry's book, The Way of Love. And in this beautiful book, one comes to see that Michael Curry is not afraid to speak the truth in love and kindness. And in so doing, he has become one of the most universally loved and respected religious leaders in our world today. Curry treats those who don't share his view with kindness and humility. And instead of dividing people into opposing tribes because of their differences, he's constantly striving to find common ground to build bridges between them. Here is a very important truth. This is not easy work, but is essential to the life work of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. It's the work of engaging justice and engaging kindness. Bishop Curry says we must find how to stand and kneel at the same time. He stands in his convictions, speaking as clearly as he can what he believes and why. And he kneels before those who disagree with him, honoring them as beloved children of God, respecting their point of view, and being willing to truly listen in a spirit of humility. If we all do that and engage each other, he says, kneeling in real humility before each other and before God, and yet being honest and upfront and clear about what we stand for, The fact that we have knelt before each other creates the space where we can stand together with our differences. If we don't show up and don't speak up in our contentious, polarized time, as tempting as that is, it's an abdication of moral ground. Yet how we act, how we speak, it matters. It matters that we show up where Jesus calls us, standing firm in what we believe to be right and true and just, and yet stay in loving relationship with those who differ, refusing to meet intolerance with more intolerance, but meeting it with love. Think of what we're capable of when we decide to show up. All of us, to show up where love is needed. Let's keep this Micah pledge before us. And may God help each and every one of us to be just and kind and humble. Please join me in prayer. Dear God, be present to us as we gather with others before you to worship. Continue to open our hearts and minds to hear your good news in your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us give thanks. Help us confess and offer the brokenness of this world and our lives to you. And as we break bread with others, may our eyes be open to the presence of Christ and the power of God's Spirit among us, making us into one body, the body of Christ, who's been sent forth to live the way of love. Amen.
He's coming out.
In a nasty mood.
A foul and nasty mood.
What are you playing at?
Pirates, sir? The Wasp is now a pirate ship. Your British crew's in chains below.
There haven't been pirates in these parts for 100 years.
Well, we've been keeping a very low profile.
And you're the captain, I suppose?
Aye, sir?
Aye, sir, you, sir?
No, sir, not me, sir.
It's me, sir.
That's me, sir, but no captain, I, sir.
You lie, sir.
Oh, no, the devil himself's in charge hereabout. The Black Staff!
Hello?
Oh, to be in England now that April's there. But whoever's not in England gets to see my facial hair. Oh, you may be wondering, can the fellow before you be entirely evil? Can no compassion uncrease this furrowed brow?
Brow.
Well, fret not, mon frere, for I'm a romantic. There's a poet in these pirate veins, and so I plug into the muse. Come see Peter and the Starcatcher March 24th, 25th, and 26th. Tickets on sale online or in the patio after church. What am I?
For over 25 years, Messiah has opened its campus to visitors through our Fine Arts Ministry, or MFAM. They've done numerous shows over the years, and coming up next weekend, they'll be putting on Peter and the Starcatcher, March 24, 25, and 26. Tickets can be purchased online or on the patio this Sunday in between worship services. Now, as we come to our offering time, in Leviticus chapter 27, we read, "Every tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the trees, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord." We give back to God what God has first allowed us to possess. Some of you are old enough to remember the hymn, "We Give Thee But Thine Own." We give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be, all that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. Everything is really the Lord's. When we give back, we remember that God allows us to use what really belongs to God, and that we are called to use those resources well and wisely. Thank you for your gifts to Messiah, which help us and you to live out our mission of loving God and loving one another. You can give to Messiah in a variety of ways: online banking or our website or our app, texting MessiahYL to the number on the screen, or writing a check to Messiah and leaving it in the offering plates on site, or mailing it or dropping it off at our office. Thank you for your generous gifts in support of Messiah and our ministry of loving God and loving one another. Now let's pray. Almighty God, Lord of heaven and earth, we ask that you continue to graciously provide for us and for our use the fruitfulness of the land and of the sea, that all who labor may prosper, and that we who receive good things from your hand may always recognize your provision and give you thanks. You confound the world's wisdom by giving your kingdom to the lowly and the pure in heart. Give us a hunger and a thirst for justice, perseverance in striving for peace, and abundant mercy for all those we meet. Just as Jesus humbled himself for us, fill us with humility so that in our words and our actions, the world may see the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now, united as one by the Holy Spirit, let's join together in the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let's sing our sending song.
Thank you once again for joining us today in Worship Online at Messiah. And now please receive the benediction. May God go before you to show you the way, above you to watch over you, beneath you to support you, beside you to be your best friend, and within you to fill you with peace, love, and uncontainable joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now let us go in peace and serve our Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.